Hello, everyone. Welcome to Wind Down Wednesdays. I'm your host, Paula Taylor, and this is episode 152. So today, I had a couple of different versions of this show in mind. We are going to do a live kirtan practice. I've been talking about that for weeks, and I had to put it off because I got sick, and last week I just didn't have the energy, didn't quite have the voice. We're going to actually talk about our voice today. And I realized all of a sudden that this was a perfect kind of continuation of last 2 weeks ago's topic, which was the sneaky, slithery slug of shame. I can't say it any better now than I did then. So you don't have to have watched or listened to that episode to participate in this episode. I do always recommend you go back. It does, these shows do kind of build on each other, but again, they also stand alone. So what we're going to talk about today is actually releasing the shame around using our voice. And so just briefly, let's define shame. We talked about this in depth last week. You can go back and listen. But just so we're kind of all on the same page, I think the best and most succinct kind of short version of a definition of shame I ever heard was just kind of a comparison of shame and grief. So grief. Shame and guilt. Okay, I need to slow myself down here and kind of come back into my body so that my brain is moving faster than my mouth. It always does, but it's particularly apparent today. So the best definition that I ever heard about what shame is actually a comparison of guilt versus shame. Guilt is feeling bad about something you've done, feeling bad about an action. Shame is feeling bad about who you are. And we talked a lot last week about how slippery and sneaky shame is, how it tends to hide underneath other emotions. And I think actually one of the best ways maybe to illustrate that is to talk about shame around using our voice, because I think every single one of us has this. And I'm going to talk to you a little bit about my experience kind of growing up, and I think that will help see you. You may have a different version of this, but I think it's pretty reflective for people to kind of hear that and recognize their own story. So you might have a different, the details of your story might be different, but the feelings underneath and kind of the experiences, I think, are fairly universal around this shame we carry about using our voice. And what do I mean by using our voice? Today we are going to do a singing practice. That is one of the most vulnerable things for people, singing, using their voice to sing. But this extends to all areas of life, really, to speaking in front of people. I still have a hard time with that. I can get up and intuitively tone and channel all sorts of weird sounds, and the minute I have to like stand up and introduce myself and say who I am and what I do, I start getting uncomfortable. So speaking in front of people, speaking your truth, speaking from an authentic place, asking for what we need. I just did a really amazing class this morning where we did a little bit of an exercise about kind of asking for what you need and how vulnerable that feels and how that can kind of bring up some emotions and this feeling of maybe being too needy. So we're going to talk about using our voice kind of generally, but I'm going to talk about singing because we're leading up to this singing practice. But just know that this kind of reverberates out through all sorts of different experiences of using our voice. So let's talk about how really, really early on in life we begin to be programmed around changing our voice. And it can be a different experience. So I'm going to tell you my experience, but I'm also going to tell you a lot of people have the opposite experience. So overall, my experience of shame around my voice is being told that I was too loud, that I was too much, that I spoke too often, that I got too excited and interrupted people. That's my story. I'm going to share that. Many people have the opposite kind of experience of that where they don't want to share their voice and they're forced to. You know, in school, sometimes you were called on against your will and made to speak in front of people. That creates a huge amount of shame. If you grew up with any kind of vocal difference, I had a lisp. Sometimes I get a little in my head when I'm speaking on the show or when I get tired, I feel like it comes through a little bit and I start to get distracted. people who had anything like that, any kind of speech impediment, a stutter, anything around that. Some people get shamed around the tone of their voice. Like, I was always told your voice carries, you need to be quieter. Some people have a really low voice. Some people have a really high voice. And it's so sad to me. It's really tragic how kind of we try to homogenize the vocal experience. We try to get women to talk higher and men to talk lower. And like, that's just not where everybody resonates. I have a fairly low voice for a woman. I resonate better at a lower frequency. And if I talk up here, it sounds very disingenuous. But a lot of us were trained into this like nasal projection of our voice. We could get into really like detailed sort of vocal anatomy. We're not going to do that. But most of us have kind of lost the connection to our authentic voice, kind of how to produce our voice in a way that feels good in our body, has a natural resonance. And we've got this shame around using it in front of other people, whether that's speaking or singing, however that appears. So I'm going to tell you a really interesting story. I was working with my craniosacral teacher. I was having a session with Heidi Wilson, Fluid Healing here in Tucson. HeidiWilsonFluidHealing.com is her website. And I had this really interesting memory come up, and interesting because it was literally within a day of being born. And you might say, like, you don't have a memory of that, or you weren't able to process that. But the thing that's so interesting about this is that way before we have language skills, we have processing skills, we have energetic literacy, we come out with this understanding of kind of feeling what's around us, feeling what's in the world, feeling whether we're loved and welcomed, or whether our needs are being met, things like that. So we were getting into this kind of memory around birth. And I know from the story of my birth that I was taken and put in an incubator, and, you know, kind of, I asked my mom, and I can't remember how long I was in there now. I asked her recently after I had this kind of experience, but this memory came through of sort of being in the incubator, and there were a couple nurses outside, and I was crying, and I was wanting to be taken out, or wanting to be held, or I had a need that needed to be met. Who knows what it was at the time? You know, I was hungry, or I needed a diaper change. Who knows? My experience, as this very, very, you know, less than 2 day old child, infant, was that I had a need that I was trying to get met. And the way that we get that across as babies is to cry, is to try to get attention through crying. And in the memory, one of the nurses said to the other nurse, "Oh, I don't want to deal with that one. It's so loud. I don't want to deal with it. It's so loud." And like, that pretty much sums up a lot of my life and the way that I have been treated around my voice. I have a naturally resonant voice. It naturally carries. And it's so interesting to me, when I was thinking about doing this topic, I received a lot of mixed messaging as a child around my voice. And I think that's probably not uncommon. I had a natural gift for singing. And so when I was singing, I was encouraged to use my voice. I was encouraged to project my voice. But I was also encouraged to use it in a certain way. We're going to talk a lot about the aesthetics of our voice and how that really gets into shame. But then on the other hand, I was in other situations, I was frequently told I was too loud, I was too bossy, which I think if you use your voice a lot, sometimes that comes across as being bossy. My voice carried, I needed to be careful, use your inside voice. It was things like that I heard over and over and over again that essentially told me I was too much. My voice was too much. My voice was too loud. I was using it too much. You know, it was things like, you need to let other people speak. You don't always want to answer the questions in class, because I was just excited. I loved learning. I loved to converse with people. I still have problems. And now I understand some of this has to do with neurodivergence, but I really relate verbally to people. I'm a verbal processor. I said, I think a couple weeks ago on the show, that part of this show for me is actually verbally processing kind of the things that I've been through, and also hopefully in a way that kind of makes sense, that helps other people process things that they've been through. But so as a verbal processor, as someone also, and this is a neurodivergent thing as well, I've learned, is sometimes I get so excited that I tend to interrupt people, or someone is telling a story and then I jump in with my story, and in my mind it's like I want to relate to them. I want them to know that I understand what they're going through, but that can come across as being dominant, as not allowing other people to have a chance, you know, to kind of talk, and not everybody gets that excited about things. So especially when you're with somebody maybe who's a little more naturally reserved or doesn't speak as much, you know, you can end up kind of talking over them to the point where they don't feel heard. So there's some legitimacy in that. You know, there's a reason we have sort of cultural programming and training and these rules of etiquette and, you know, allowing, learning how to have a back and forth. But also, the way that we're trained around those things creates a lot of shame. So again, the shame for me is like, be careful what you say. It might be too much. It might be too loud. You might be talking too much, to the point where sometimes I'm not even actually embodied in a conversation because I'm worried about the shame is talking to me in the background. Oh, don't say too much. Don't dominate the conversation. Don't interrupt the person, you know, and there's all these sort of little shame cues I have to pay attention to. And then I'm not actually really engaging with the person. So this programming that we receive eventually kind of takes over. And again, if you had kind of the opposite experience, like my husband is a pretty shy person, he's fairly reserved. And so sometimes, like even when I met him, he didn't really say anything much. For the first like 3 or 4 times we were together, it was like in a group setting. And he's not somebody who's going to jump in and kind of take over. He's going to wait for an opportunity. And when you're with people who are kind of more talkative, that may never come. And so then that comes across, or those people get shamed about being too shy or being too reserved or not being talkative enough or not being verbal. So there's, from a very young age, we start to get programmed around our voices and we internalize that programming, and it does, for most of us, it kind of gets held as this shame. And all I need to do, I think, to demonstrate this is to do just a really short visualization. And you can do this as speaking or singing. Singing might be even worse. But if I asked you to just take a second and close your eyes and imagine that you are on a stage in front of many people. And that can be, depending on how much is overwhelming for you, it could be 10 people, it could be 50 people, it could be 5,000 people. But you're standing on a stage, there's lights on you, and everybody's looking at you, and they're waiting for you to either speak or sing. Just notice how that feels in your body. There's probably like a, oh gosh, no, kind of feeling, like a contraction somewhere in your body. And just look for that. And maybe not. Maybe you're someone that's really comfortable with public speaking or singing in front of people. So try to find the scenario that makes you uncomfortable. Maybe 10 people isn't enough. Maybe you need 50. Or maybe a smaller group feels worse. Maybe talking in front of 10 people is much more overwhelming sounding than talking in front of 50 or 500. So just kind of find that scenario and feel the discomfort in your body. Like I can actually feel a contraction in my belly. And then that like kind of lends to a tightening in my chest and a tightening in my throat. So here's the thing that's so interesting. So we just found that shame around using our voice in our body, however it presented for you. And what happens is that it actually shuts down the centers that create sound. So when we create sound with our voices, and it's especially apparent when you sing, you need a base of support all the way down from the root of your pelvis. So the very lowest part of your belly, the sacral area, and then the solar plexus. All of these areas support your voice coming out. I mean, that's when I project my voice. Some of that now is training, but again, some of it, I just was born with this sort of projection. I was born with a gift of using my voice. And actually, the best example I can think about that is Freddie Mercury, who is the singer for Queen. They've actually studied his mouth. He had a kind of an unusually shaped mouth, and he was able to produce sounds that most humans cannot because of the shape of his mouth, because of the shape of his kind of throat and mouth, the configuration. And so some people are born to share their voice. I think that is true. I think all of us can learn how to share our voice. And I think all of us have shame around sharing our voice. I think if you talked to the most popular singer, you know, think of whatever your generation is, think of somebody that's like fills stadiums, they're going to tell you that they had to do a lot of training around overcoming shame around their voice or stage fright, which is really just kind of the expression of that shame of being seen. And that's really what this is. This is an extension of that shame of being seen, of being vulnerable. And I think I said this in the last show, I'm going to expand on this a little bit. I think it was Brené Brown who said that vulnerability is the antidote to shame. I'm going to add authenticity, vulnerability. Oh, what was my third word? It just went totally out of my head. And transparency. So being truthful, being transparent about what you're going through, right away, all that already creates the vulnerability. That is how we kind of get over the shame. And it's so apparent when we do it with the voice. So when I asked you to think about speaking or singing in front of people and you had this contraction somewhere in your body, maybe it was the chest, maybe it was the throat, maybe it was the belly, maybe it was everything, maybe you just felt like you wanted to curl into a little ball and hide, what that does is that it actually shuts down the vocal apparatus. It also shuts down the energy centers that are responsible for kind of sharing the voice. And something that's really interesting is that the sacral chakra is kind of the well of creativity. This is where ideas kind of come up from. But the throat is how we express creativity. So another way that we kind of get shamed around sharing our voice is, think about a time when you shared an idea and somebody just said, oh, that's stupid. That's the dumbest thing I've ever heard. I think everyone's had that experience too. You know, oh, I've got this idea. And again, it takes courage. It takes vulnerability to say, oh, well, what about this? And so when somebody doesn't just kind of disagree with you, but actually dismisses you, actually, you know, kind of, it's very demoralizing. It's very demeaning. And I feel like we've all had that experience, you know, where you, it's not just like you said, hey, well, what about this? And they were like, oh yeah, that, you know, I'm not sure that's going to work. Like, that's a different experience of this, like, well, what about this? And someone saying something judgmental, that's stupid, that's dumb, that's never going to work. Why are you even trying? Stuff like that. That is stored in the body as shame around using the voice, because you had to use your voice to express what you wanted, to ask for a need, and it got shut down. And so what happens is that the physical apparatus, the support from down below, and then the openness of the throat, any professional singer will tell you that their whole job is to learn to relax, to really, because you really want things to vibrate. Just very briefly, let's talk about how the voice is produced. Just so you've got these vocal cords, and they vibrate together. They kind of like vibrate on each other, and that is actually what produces sound. And the air comes up, and a good way to picture this is to think about a clarinet, or a lot of people don't know what an oboe is, so we'll stick with a clarinet. So a clarinet has a mouthpiece, and that has a wooden reed. And as you blow into this little hole between the reed and the mouthpiece, the reed vibrates. And that's actually what produces sound. On an oboe, there's reeds on both sides. That's why we call it a double reed or a bassoon. And the reed vibrates together as you blow through it, and it produces sound. That's essentially kind of how the vocal cords work. So if you have a really hard reed, whether it's clarinet or oboe or bassoon, you're not going to get very much sound because you're not getting enough vibration. So the same thing happens in the throat. If your throat is shut down and you're really tight in the throat, it's actually going to affect how the voice comes out of your throat. And again, we're going to talk a little bit about singing, but this is true for talking as well. People who speak for a living, a lot of them do training around this idea of deep belly breathing, of getting this support. There's really like a tube that kind of runs all the way up the body that helps express the voice. And if you think about that idea of this creative kind of force rising up and then being shared in a way that's really open, you want the support from underneath, that really strong idea, and then you want the openness for it to come through. So that's kind of physically how the voice comes through the body in a really simplified way. So any experience we have that causes contraction around using the voice physically limits the voice, energetically limits the voice, and eventually a lot of us are really so kind of contracted and shameful around the voice that the thought of talking in front of people, or especially singing in front of people, just like forget about it. It's like the stuff of nightmares for a lot of people. So let's talk a little bit about singing in front of people and why and how that's so vulnerable, and how as a society in the West especially, we've really set ourselves up to fail. So I said I grew up singing. I love to sing. Now I recognize it. It's literally part of who I am. This ability and desire to sing and share my voice vocally. And so I did. I sang all the time as a kid. I sang in the choir. I sang in the church choir, the school choir. But at the same time, I was receiving that same programming, that shameful programming around using my voice and around being seen. And so when I was about 16, there's some nuance to this, and there's physical causes, but I actually developed nodules on my vocal cords, growths on my vocal cords that meant I was pretty much like talking like this all the time. And I really wasn't supposed to talk. I was supposed to rest my voice. And also, not at all coincidentally, that is around the age when my eating disorder really took hold, when my fear of being seen really like solidified. I had a really rough year when I was 16, and all of these things sort of came together, and I physically couldn't talk. And I didn't sing from 16 to about 21, really at all. A little bit here and there, maybe with family or friends, not publicly, I will say that for sure. My last semester of college, I got brave enough to take vocal lessons with an opera teacher. She was a graduate student. And every lesson, she would stand behind me and like kind of touch my shoulders and just say, "You're so tense, you need to release your tension." Well, she couldn't teach me how to do that because it wasn't tension. It was physical tension, but the cause of the tension was emotional. The cause of the tension was all that shame, all those years around. Like, I don't want to be seen. I don't want to be heard. I don't want to make a mistake. And this is where we have done such a huge disservice to ourselves. So if I asked you to think about the best singers, how do we find the best singers? And I'm in America, so we're going to use America. How do we find the best singers? And you might, right away, think of a bunch of like talent searching shows. When I was a kid, it was Star Search. Oh my God, I dreamed of going on Star Search. It's probably good that I didn't, but I dreamed of it. You know, then we had American Idol. Now we've got The Voice. We've got America's Got Talent. I mean, and these exist all over the world. I'm just being American-centric, because that's where I am. You know, you've got Britain's Got Talent. You've got, you know, all over the world. And the problem with this is that, again, we have really homogenized this idea of what a quote-unquote good voice is. And I've seen that change and shift a little bit over the years, which is nice. But really what we still, idolize is what I'm going to call virtuosic singing. So this is people like Mariah Carey is the first example that I can think of, or Christina Aguilera. These are people who can hit 50 notes in like 3 seconds and they sound really, really good. You know, they can, in music, virtuosic or virtuosity essentially is like playing a lot of notes really quickly. And that is one form of talent. That is one form of aesthetically pleasing sound. We also, to a lesser degree, I think, do recognize the aesthetics and the enjoyment of what I'm going to call lyricism. Somebody who's like a folk singer, someone like Carole King, somebody like Joe Cocker. These are people that don't have these clear as a bell voices. They don't do a lot of notes in a brief time, but they really, James Taylor, these are people who sing they're very expressive in how they sing. But we've really kind of elevated to this pedestal, this virtuosic idea of singing. And most people don't have the apparatus for that. No matter how good I get as a singer, I'm never going to be a virtuosic singer. I was not a virtuosic oboe player. I learned to embrace the lyricism and the expressiveness and the emotiveness, like, of making music. And that is really, that's where the soul of the music lies. That's where the depth of the music lies. I mean, the best musicians can do both. And that's very rare. It's rare that people can do both. And it's funny, if you listen to people who are really virtuosic, Kelly Clarkson is someone that comes to mind, and she's gotten better over the years. But when she was first on American Idol, when she had to sing lower or she had to sing slower, she didn't have a lot of support. Taylor Swift started out that way, and she's, you know, she's gotten a lot of training. She's gotten a lot better. I'm not dissing Taylor Swift. I don't want to go down that road. My point is just, we have chosen a certain aesthetic that we sort of enjoy. And the focus on singing is on aesthetics. I mean, the focus on a lot of things in our society is on aesthetics. How do you look? How do things look on the surface? How fancy is this? How beautiful is this? And it's the same thing with the voice. And we've done ourselves a disservice because most people don't sing that way. And the joy of singing is not really about the reaction you get. That's there. We're human, of course. The joy of using your voice is the connection you get to yourself using your voice. The embodiment you get, feeling that kind of vibration move through your body. I mean, now we're going to talk about vocal practice as a spiritual practice. So I want to just, I've said this so many times, I'm never going to stop saying this. There is a complete separation. We are in two different worlds. Singing for aesthetic pleasing is nothing like practicing a spiritual vocal practice. In a spiritual vocal practice, I want to hear the so-called imperfections in your voice because that tells me that energy is moving through the voice. And people in this sort of spiritual vocal world who we really enjoy listening to, they have really clear voices. There's not a lot of sort of that like roughness or bobbling in the voice. Again, it's just a choice we've made. These are people that practice so often, that warm up so much that those things go away and they have a really smooth voice. And I talk about this when I teach chant to people, and we've talked about it not for a long time. We've done a couple of episodes where we've used some chant. When you start out, you're going to get a lot of wobbling and warbling, and that is partly as your vocal cords warm up. There's a physical component to that, but also we're moving energy. Using our voice is one of the best ways we have to move energy, physically moving energy through the body. And so when we get those little so-called imperfections, those little blips and blorbles and having to stop and cough and like clear your throat, those are all good things in a vocal practice. Whereas from an aesthetic point of view, you know, if you're watching The Voice and somebody come, you know, in the middle of their song, probably nobody would turn their chair around for them. And that's too bad because maybe they didn't warm up properly and they have a fantastic voice. Again, that's aesthetics versus practice versus experiential. What does this feel like in my body? I'm doing this for myself. It doesn't matter who's around. It doesn't matter who's listening to me. It doesn't matter how it sounds, because this is something I do for me to move energy, to expand my energetic field, and to release trauma. I mean, we release trauma through our voice. So originally I was going to call this episode The Power of Using Your Voice. And I decided to kind of link it to this idea of releasing shame. So how do we release shame? How do we start working with our voice? And it's a really, it's tough. It starts on your own. Absolutely, it starts on your own. it starts kind of in hermit mode, doing things by yourself, or it starts in a really supportive, loving environment where you have a group practice. One of my intentions for this year is to start a group sound practice, a kirtan practice, probably in person, but maybe also virtually, depending on how the technology works. It's really empowering to sing in a group or chant in a group. For me, when I got out of college, I kind of interrupted my story and went on an ADHD tangent. When I got out of college, I didn't sing again for a really long time, but I started chanting. And my first experience of chant was in yoga classes. But when I lived in San Jose, I was about 22 years old, I think. And I found this, it was called the Center for Spiritual Enlightenment, something like that. And it was a temple, they called it a temple. And it was this place where they had, there was a big tree growing up in the middle of this temple. It was really beautiful. And they had all different religious symbols. And it was about mindfulness and loving kindness and things that I still kind of associate with Buddhism, but it wasn't a Buddhist organization. They would use, the minister would talk, you know, she would quote from the Quran, she would quote from the Bible, she would quote from like all different religious texts, kind of. It was like finding the commonality. What's the spirituality under religion? But the way I started attending this place was that they had a midweek chant service. It was like noon on Wednesdays or something. And I was like, oh, that sounds intriguing. And it, oh my God, it was just so amazing. And it was my first experience. I grew up in the Catholic Church. There's a lot of kind of repetitive sound making, but I never felt connected to that. And when I looked around, I felt like most of the people around me weren't really connected to that. I mean, we would sing together. It felt very like obligatory to me as opposed to joyful. And again, that's just my experience. A lot of people probably don't have that experience, but that was my experience. So I went to this place and every week it was a different chant. And I think they had live musicians, which does always enliven things. It makes it a little more fun. There was pretty much no talking. It was like, this is the chant for this week. And we would all start singing. And sometimes it was a kirtan style practice where it's kind of a call and response. They sing a line, you sing a line. Sometimes we just all sang together. But it was basically, it was about 20, 25 minutes of singing, of chant, and I'm using chant, but sometimes it was more like a song. The line there is kind of different. I think for me, it helps me think about how to use my voice. It's a whole different show, and I've already gotten on a few different tangents. I want to get into the practice. So we would sing, we would chant together for a good like 20, 25 minutes, and then there would just be complete silence for anywhere from like 10 to 15 minutes. And it was such a powerful practice of just getting, you get into this flow, the repetition of singing the same thing over and over again. It's called entrainment. You get into this rhythm, you get into rhythm with the music or whatever it is that you're singing, but it also physically changes the vibration in the space. So you've got all these people using their voice and the vibrations in the space are changing. And then you stop and you just sit and feel the shift. And it's amazing. I mean, it happens all the time now when I do sound journeys with people. I always point out how important the silence is. That's the integration time. In a yoga practice, we go into Shavasana or corpse pose to integrate the movement we've done. So this is the same thing. We're going to move all this energy using our voice, and then we're going to sit and just see, notice the shift. Notice the shift in the space around us. Notice the shift within. It's really profound work, and it doesn't have to be complicated. You know, it can be, that's one of the reasons I love the Sat Nam chant, because it's just Sat and Nam over and over again. There's nothing to learn, and it really does shift your perception. That's the one I love for anxiety, where we move high to low. It really brings the energy down and kind of grounds people. So let's talk a little bit about what we're going to do today. And I'm going to explain a little bit about why I'm doing it this way, because I made a very conscious, intentional decision about this for a reason that actually led into this whole sort of topic about shame and the voice. So I decided I wanted to do this for our holiday episode this year, and then I was sick, and then my voice is still not totally okay, and that's okay. I'm going to be transparent about that purposely, because this is not about aesthetics. I could not say that enough times to really get it the point across. So when I thought about this, I picked a song and I said to my husband, oh, I think maybe I'll have you come in and play guitar. You know, we did that for the very first anniversary of the show when I wrote a my kirtan, We Are Love, for that specific episode. 2 years later, 2.5 years later, it's finally released, and you can find it on Spotify, Apple Music, anywhere you stream music. Really beautiful. It's a really beautiful song that holds the frequency, the emerald frequency of dimensional frequency expansion. And I thought about doing that today, but I'm like, oh, we already did that. I'm going to do something else. So I picked a different song. It's not a traditional kirtan song. We'll talk a little bit about it. And I was like, oh, I'm going to have you play guitar. And then I was like, you know what? No, I'm not. Because if we're talking about releasing shame, it's great to have accompaniment. It's fun. It fills the space. But it also acts a little bit as something to hide behind. Like if I have someone playing guitar and I need to stop and take a breath, like I haven't completely stopped the practice. Or if I have to clear my throat or something, honestly, it really gives me something to kind of hide behind. And I was like, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to sing a cappella, meaning there's nothing else. I don't have a recorded backing track. I don't have a musician here with me. And I'm doing that on purpose because part of the way that we release shame is through authenticity, transparency, and vulnerability. So I'm going to be really vulnerable with you. I have no one else here. I'm hoping you'll sing along with me whenever you're practicing this. But it's just me. So I don't know what's going to happen. My voice is still not completely right. I've still been having some asthma problems. So my intention is that we're going to sing, hopefully for around 11 minutes. I might have to stop and take a break and just redirect you to your breath for a little while and then go back into it. I might make it through and it'll be fantastic. I might have to stop and clear my throat. You are going to hear imperfections, quote unquote, in quotes, in my voice. And I want you to hear those because I want you to know that not only is that okay, that should be celebrated. Because what you'll notice is the longer you sing, we're going to sing a really repetitive thing over and over again, those will start to kind of smooth out and you get into this rhythm. You get into this rhythm with your body, your vocal cords. I purposely did not warm up like I would if I was going to sing a gig or something. Like, this is just me starting, and I want you to hear, you know, exactly what happens, because I want you to know that it's okay. I am, at this point, a semi-professional singer or vocal toner. I vocalize constantly. I vocalize in one-on-one sessions. I vocalize in front of people for sound baths. I sing, I don't have a lot of time right now, but I sing jazz sometimes in gigs. So I am not perfect. I have training. I do this all the time. And there are just days that I'm not feeling it, or my voice is more hoarse, or I'm dehydrated, or I'm getting a lot of bobbles because there's energy to be released. This is not about aesthetics. This is about the experience. This is about feeling what happens when you get into this rhythm. So really briefly, because I want to get into the practice, I want to tell you the song we're going to sing, and I want to give you a chance. I debated, like, what's the best way to do this. I actually wrote the lyrics down. I was like, I can try to hold them up. I think they'll be backwards for you. So we are going to sing a song called It's in Every One of Us, and that song is by David Pomeranz. And we're just going to sing a short bit of it. There's actually, I didn't even realize because I've only ever heard this shorter bit. It's the lyrics are really evocative. It's a really beautiful song. It's very simple, and we're going to repeat it over and over again. So my suggestion, when in the podcast, I'm going to put the lyrics in the podcast notes so you can see them. If you're watching this and let's say you're on your computer, pull the lyrics up on your phone perhaps. And then the other thing is I'm going to read the lyrics before we start. And so you could actually write them down. But what you'll find is even if you're unfamiliar, like a lot of times when I was chanting back in the day, it was in a totally different language, and sometimes they're fairly long and complicated. Like, eventually you just start to pick it up, and the repetitiveness, you'll start to learn the song, you'll start to learn the words, and it'll just kind of come through and feel really good. I think in the meditation itself, I'm going to read the words once, and then I'm just going to start. And again, I don't know what's going to happen. I might have to stop. I might have to take a little break in the middle. We might go all the way through. Again, this is not about how it sounds. This is about how it feels. And I'm really going to direct you, especially at the end, I'm going to hold quite a bit of silence I want you to really notice what happens in your body. Notice the shift in your body. Notice the feelings that come up. You might get a lot of really judgmental feelings about yourself. You might get judgmental feelings about me, which is just a kind of a projection of how you feel about yourself. You know, so anything that comes up is okay. And just notice it. You know, you might have sometimes I have this response like, this is dumb. Why am I doing this? I know now, I know what myself well enough to know that I'm encountering some resistance. You might find some resistance to this practice, and that's okay. Sit with the resistance. Breathe through the resistance. If you're not ready to sing along, just listen. But I really do encourage you to come back and do this a few times until you get to the point where you feel like you can sing along. Last thing about this, no one's judging you. No one's listening to you. If you don't match my pitch, that's completely fine. If you're someone who considers yourself to be like tone deaf and you can't carry a tune, you can kind of even just drone the lyrics. The point is to kind of get the rhythm going and get the sense of the repetition. So again, this is not a vocal talent competition and nobody is judging you. You will be judging yourself. And again, like, I was thinking about this. I want to sound good. I'm going to make an effort to sing well for you, but because I'm human and that's part of who I am. But I also am going to recognize the shame that comes up when I do have a little bobble or a little thing, and I'm going to do my best to let it go. I've done this kind of practice enough that I've gotten to the point where it's easier, but it's not easy. It's still difficult for me to sing in front of people. I could vocally tone all sorts of weird light language stuff. And because in that case, someone used the term being sung. I'm being sung. I'm a channel. I'm just letting things through. There's something about singing of your own volition that is so much more vulnerable. And that is where the antidote to that shame lies. That is why it is important. And there's a way to kind of bridge the gap. Again, as you get into that repetition, you do start to kind of feel more like things are channeling and they're flowing and less like you're kind of trying to make it happen, which is some of the magic of this practice. So let's meditate together. So for this meditation, this vocal practice, this spiritual vocal practice, you will want to sit up. You might even like to stand. The more support you have from the bottom of the belly, the easier it's going to be to produce these sounds, to sing this song with me. So find that position. You want to be supported. You want a nice tall spine. So maybe you put something up behind your back if you're sitting on a couch or on a chair. Maybe you're sitting on a stool for this one to just kind of give yourself that extra feeling of support. Let's do three nice deep oxytocin breaths in through the nose and out through the mouth. We're going to add that audible ha sound, get those vocal cords vibrating a little bit. Ha. Do that at least two more times, just coming fully present into the body. And we're going to essentially just get right into this vocal practice of using our voices. I'm going to encourage you to sing along. You may need to listen to this two or three times before you join in. You may want to pull the lyrics up on your phone, and I'm also going to read them once here for you. So this is an excerpt from It's in Every One of Us by David Pomeranz. It's in every one of us to be wise. Find your heart. Open up both your eyes. We can all know everything without ever knowing why. It's in every one of us by and by. At any point here, if you need to take a break, if you need to take an oxytocin breath, feel free to do that. I may need to do that at some point, and that's fine. I'm going to try to keep the rhythm going the best I can, but we'll just be in flow here. Really connect to your belly as you're breathing. Think about that oxytocin breath, that big, strong breath in through the nose. Let that belly float out as you get ready to sing. And just know for this type of a practice, You can breathe anywhere you need to. Don't worry so much about the words or if you're breathing in a place that feels weird. Like, honor your body here. We're really moving energy with our voice. That's the purpose of this. This is a beautiful song, but the purpose of this is not beauty. It's the beauty of connection with yourself. And it might feel really good to put a couple hands on your belly or put a hand on your belly and a hand on your heart. Just experiment around with what feels good here. It's in every one of us to be wise. Find your heart. Open up both your eyes. We can all know everything without ever knowing why. It's in every one of us, by and by. It's in every one of us to be wise. Find your heart. Open up both your eyes. We can all know everything without ever knowing why. It's in every one of us, by and by. It's in every one of us to be wise. Find your heart. Open up both your eyes. We can all know everything without ever knowing why. It's in every one of us, by and by. It's in every one of us to be wise. Find your heart. Open up both your eyes. We can all know everything without ever knowing why. It's in every one of us, by and by. It's in every one of us to be wise, find your heart, open up both your eyes. We can all know everything without ever knowing why. It's in every one of us by and by. It's in every one of us to be wise. Find your heart, open up both your eyes. We can all know everything without ever knowing why. It's in every one of us by and by. It's in every one of us to be wise. Find your heart, open up both your eyes. We can all know everything without ever knowing why. It's in every one of us by and by. It's in every one of us to be wise. Find your heart, open up both your eyes. We can all know everything without ever knowing why. It's in every one of us by and by. It's in every one of us to be wise. Find your heart, open up both your eyes. We can all know everything without ever knowing why. It's in every one of us by and by.
It's in every one of us to be wise. Find your heart, open up both your eyes. We can all know everything without ever knowing why. It's in every one of us, by and by. It's in every one of us to be wise. Find your heart, open up all your eyes. We can all know everything without ever knowing why. It's in every one of us, by and by, by and by.
So stay with the silence here. Stay with whatever emotion is coming up. Notice the shift in your body. Notice the shift in your mind. Notice the shift in the space around you, and just let yourself be with that for a few moments. Know that this practice is so powerful and so profound, and that even if it feels scary, even if you feel resistance, this is such a beautiful way to honor yourself, to connect with yourself, and to move and release energy. Give yourself some gratitude for staying with this practice, however you showed up for it. hold a little space for the judgments that came up. And recognize that those judgments are just a reflection of that shame, that programming around the fact that using your voice, that embracing your voice, that tapping into the power of your own voice is somehow not safe. And know that the more you come back to this, the more you can begin to dismantle that programming, dismantle that shame, the more you begin to empower yourself and your own authentic voice, the more you begin to connect with your body, and the more we can honor each other through this collective practice of holding a safe and non-judgmental space for our fellow human beings to express themselves, to share their voice, to be heard with love and respect and non-judgment. And it begins with that non-judgment of yourself, with that recognition that that shame may be buried deeply, but that using your voice allows you to move and release some of that shame, to release some of that judgment, and to create that safe, non-judgmental space for yourself. And from there, that reverberates out to create safe and non-judgmental space for others. Take a few really nice deep breaths. You might want to add that oxytocin ha sound. Again, this may have been really deep and profound for you, and it may not have, and there's no judgment. But give yourself a few more moments here to release any of that energy that was moved through that deep breath. You might actually want to do a little bit of shaking, just gently shaking the body, maybe shrugging the shoulders, just moving any of that energy that's maybe still a little bit stuck and ready to be released. You can shake your head yes and no a little bit. And just before we come out of this, place a hand on your throat, just really gently. Place a hand on your heart or your belly, whatever you're called to. And send some love and gratitude into these beautiful spaces of vibration, these beautiful spaces of expression and of empowerment, these beautiful places that deserve to be open and vibrating, to be transparent and authentic and vulnerable without fear. Maybe send just even the intention to give yourself permission to open the throat, especially a little bit here. I'm going to assist you with a little bit of Reiki through this transmission, allowing some space in the throat, allowing that beautiful voice box space physically and energetically to vibrate, to speak into creation, to speak into being, to speak into and unto reality. We have that power to speak and make things real. Just tapping into that here for the last moment or two. And as you're ready, you can release your hands. Just allow them to relax down. Take another couple of deep breaths as it feels good. Sat Nam. The truth of your identity is that you are a beautiful, magnificent being of creation, and you deserve the empowerment and the courage and the space to create using your beautiful voice, your powerful voice. And so it is. Feel free to stay here if you've got some time really absorbing this practice, noticing the feelings that arise, reaching out for help if this feels a little bit challenging, but recognizing the power and the safety in coming back to this practice, in moving energy through this vibration of your voice, releasing trauma in this way, releasing shame, releasing programming, and finding the authenticity of who you are underneath those things, a magnificent being of vibration, of love, of creation. As you're ready, no rush. Just begin to slowly move the body. Again, really deeply honoring any feelings that have come up here. Taking your time, maybe staying with this for a while. But as you're ready, just coming back to yourself with gentle movements, with gentle breaths. And when you feel ready, opening your eyes. Thank you so much for joining me, for allowing yourself the courage to vibrate more fully with each passing moment. This is what you are here for. Feel that deeply in your body, in your heart space, and know that you are loved. Have a beautiful rest of your day or evening, and I will see you for the next episode of Wind Down Wednesdays.